Hey everyone, and welcome back to Nioh. On this video, we're going to be checking out the world map. We're going to learn more about the story and characters and enemies and stuff like that. We're going to go to the blacksmith and see all the things that she can do. And we're going to do the Way of the Ninja Novice tutorial. So I loaded back into the game and it says my mission changed to Twilight Mission, which will make sense in just a moment. So here we are on the world map. And over here we've got our starting point, which is kind of a weird name for it. It's where your dojo is, the blacksmith, a shrine, your storage, things like that. So it's more like a home base. We've got these, I guess we'll call them banners on the map. These are your missions. So this one's a submission. It's Death to Bandits, mission level 10. And it shows you the rewards if you complete it. And then there's also the mission we did, the Isle of Demons. So you can see that's checked off, we completed it, and we got 9 of the 9 Kodama. Then over here is our main mission, Deep in the Shadows, level 10. And then off on the left, sort of in shadow, are the Twilight missions. This is a high-risk, high-reward Twilight mission. Enemies are stronger, but you also have the chance to obtain strong equipment. You can only play a Twilight mission when Twilight comes. And you can see these Twilight missions are super high level. This one's mission level 125, and this one's 145. So we're obviously not going to be doing that for a very long time. Okay, next up we can open up our menu, and our Amrita Memories has a whole bunch of new stuff on it. So it's got 4 new categories. We're going to be checking those out. It's going to teach us more about the enemies in the game and the story and all that. So this one's View Details and Models of Yokai. First off, we've got a Dweller. Dwellers are humans turned into Yokai by the foul miasma in the depths of a mine. They were objects of loathing and terror for miners, and legends about them circulate wherever a mine with a long history is found. Their grotesquely altered forms inspire instinctive revulsion in all who can bear to view them. So that's the type of Yokai we were mostly fighting in that mission. And if we were to kill 100 of them, we'd get some more lore. Next up, we got the Yoki, a human turned fiend by the power of Amrita, also known as a form of Oni, a muscular, horned humanoid dwelling in the mountains. The Shuten Doji is the most famous. So too are the Oni who are fought by Momotaru, the Peach Boy. Every February in Japan, a ritual called Setsubun is undertaken where citizens scatter beans to drive away Oni and pray for good health. And if we defeat 40 of them, we get some more lore for them. Next, we've got the Onlyoki, pronounned Onlyoki, a huge red Oni born from a pack of angry ghosts. Half of its face is contorted in anger, the other twisted with grudge. The faces of countless vengeful ghosts appear across its body, letting out shrieks that send terror down the spines of all within earshot. So that was the boss of that last mission we did, the Isle of Demons, and apparently there's going to be more of these guys, because we get lore for killing 2 and 3 of them. And that's all for our yokai at the moment. Next we have the Guardian Spirit Illustrations, View Details and Models of Guardian Spirits. First up we got Kato, a fire elemental. Legend has it that a she-wolf hit by a shooting star in the first month of her pregnancy will give birth to a Kato. These fire-eating hounds are said to cause the forest fires sparked by lightning strikes. Harbingers of house fires and other misfortunes, Kato are venerated as servants of the god of fire. And we've got Sirshu, aquatic guardian spirit that resembles the marrow of Celtic legend, with feathered wings and a fish's tail. Sirshu can warn of impending danger and sense Amrita. She has been with William since he was a child, and is both friend and family to him now. Or perhaps something more. Her name is pronounced Sirshu and means freedom in Gaelic. Okay, next we have the character directory. A few details and models of the game's characters. First up, we got William, the main character. William is an Irish-born English sailor. While still a boy, he lost both parents in the war with England, but also met his guardian spirit, Sirshu. The two have been inseparable ever since. Overcoming these early tragedies, William grew to be a strong and capable young man and threw in his lot with an English Navy privateer, a pirate ship in all but name. Sirshu's special ability to locate powerful Amrita spirit stones allowed him to flourish as a pirate for a time, but when he stumbled upon a secret military project to weaponize Amrita, he was imprisoned in the Tower of London. Just before William escaped the Tower of London, the alchemist Edward Kelly stole Seershu from him. Determined to get Seershu back, William followed Kelly doggedly across perilous seas all the way to Japan. But nothing he had heard about this fabled country of gold had prepared him for the realm of supernatural peril and death it proved to be. And there's more lore we can unlock as we complete more missions. Next we have Hattori Hanzo. Hattori Hanzo is a ninja in the service of Tokugawa Ieyasu. His real name is Masanari. Hanzo is a name inherited by each successive head of the ninja clan in Iga Province, present-day Western Mie Prefecture. Although his father was known as Hanzo the Oni, the current Hanzo has more of his father's skill as a ninja than his prowess as a military commander. He is a master of intelligence, concealment, and sabotage, and leads an army of several hundred ninja who lurk in the shadows, waiting to carry out secret orders from their lord. As one of the few people in Japan with knowledge of foreign languages, Hanzo also guides the newly arrived William in his search for Kelly. And once we complete the Way of the Ninja Novice, which is what we're going to be doing in a bit, we'll get some more lore. And then there's lots more to uncover. Next, we have Derek the Executioner. Derek is the Tower of London's executioner. He himself had committed a crime deserving the death penalty, but was pardoned on the condition that he take on his current position. He has ended the lives of over 3,000 people in the years since then, including political prisoners and dissidents, in grisly public spectacles that often featured his gigantic axe. A brutal man to begin with, he grew more and more violent over the course of his duties, and although he obeys the orders of Kelly and his associates faithfully, he no longer speaks. In fact, he shows no sign of emotion or intelligence at all. As well as decapitation, he also executes people by hanging, and even invented a device for hoisting people off the ground rather than dropping them from above. His name is still used for that type of crane even in our day. And if we defeat something else, maybe he comes back later, we get another piece of lore for him. And finally, we have Edward Kelly. Edward Kelly is an English alchemist. Having mastered the secret of turning lead into gold, he uses Amrita to turn humans into monsters and reanimate corpses. He has a guardian spirit named Ouroboros and is able to disappear, disguise himself as another, and steal other people's guardian spirits to use for his own purposes. On the orders of John Dee, he stole Seershu, who was able to detect Amrita from William, and set out for Japan, a land full of high-quality Amrita lying fallow. He is a cruel and determined, willing to do anything to achieve his goals. He thrives in the chaos of war, taking sadistic pleasure in human suffering. And as we complete more missions, we'll learn more about him and defeat certain enemies. Alright, and finally we have the story. Now, as we've been playing, the story hasn't been exactly all that clear, but this makes it much... this gives more detail as to what's actually going on, so we can sort of piece it all together. And you can also re-watch the cutscenes you've already seen. So we've got the opening. The country of Japan finds itself in ruins, as endless wars have led to the land being overrun by malevolent demons known as yokai. With the lands divided into two factions by the Battle of Sekigahara, a blonde-haired, blue-eyed samurai named William makes his mark. Looks to make his mark. Then we got the prologue. At the end of the 16th century, England and Spain are locked in a struggle for control of the world. Eventually, they come to learn of the existence of special stones known as Amrita, which contain a unique spiritual power that can mean the difference between victory and defeat. Prisoner of Fate, England, 1597. William finds himself locked away in a dungeon cell located beneath the Tower of London. Suddenly, the guardian spirit known as Seershu appears to warn him of danger, setting in motion a chain of events that take William on an ill-fated adventure. A deadly encounter. William defeats Derek the Executioner, but is immediately confronted by Edward Kelly the Alchemist. Using the power of Amrita to perform his mystic arts, Kelly resurrects Derek and commands him to attack William. The abduction of Seershu. Drawing upon the power of Seershu, William is able to defeat the demonic Derek for a second time. However, in the confusion, Seershu is taken prisoner by Kelly. Unarmed and finding himself trapped by the tower guards, William leaps from the Tower of London into the icy waters of the Thames below. and Voyage of the Lifte. William sets out after Kelly in order to rescue Sirshu. Once aboard the Dutch merchant ship known as Lifte, William follows a mystical compass that contains a faint trace of Sirshu's power. After a journey spanning multiple years, William finds himself in a faraway land to the east known as Japan. And then once we got to Japan, we're in the Kyushu region. With the Lifte moored offshore, William takes a small skiff to the island's sandy shores. Upon his arrival, he sees some corpses belonging to the island's natives, their bodies covered with some kind of grotesque creatures. Into the fire, in the cargo hold of a sailing ship on the island, William finds the remains of some unfortunate prisoners who were left behind. Suddenly, he is attacked by a giant, Onryoki, that was born from the restless spirits of the dead. And then, Hattori Hanzo the Ninja. William slays the Onryoki and escapes from the ship just as it bursts into flames. There to greet him is a mysterious ninja known as Hattori Hanzo, who agrees to help William find Kelly after seeing him slay the Oni. Determined to see his quest through to the end, William accepts Hanzo's offer. Alright, so we're sort of caught up on everything. We have a much better understanding now. And next we're going to go check out the starting point. So you can see we've got a shrine, we've got the blacksmith, we've got the dojo, we've got a Toti gate, which can't be used offline. I'm not sure what that does. Well, let's just go online, why not? Still don't know what this does. Okay, so you can play in different online modes. And then we've got the hidden tea house. This ability has not been unlocked yet. And we've got the storehouse where some of our items are being kept. So let's go to the shrine first. And I want to level up. We've got a whole bunch of Amrita. And I want some new stuff. Or new stats, rather. So, heart seems really good. I'm going to put some more points into that. We'll put 4 into that. Let's put 1 into skill, the amount required to activate the special effects of more technical weapons and armor. Mostly affects dual swords and guns, but the reason I want some skill is because it's needed to equip certain items. So let's just put 1 point into there. We got dexterity, determines the effect and capacity of your ninjutsu, which we're going to be learning very soon. So let's just put a point into that. You can see it raises my ninjutsu power quite a bit. And capacity and skill points. So that is very good. And we're going to put 1 into spirit. Affects the power of your guardian spirit. And as I understand it, there are passives that you get as well. So I haven't quite figured out how many points I need to put into it to get those passives. But for now, we'll just put 1 point as I figure that out. And let's see. I've got enough for 1 more level. Let's just put another into body. Give myself some more life and more damage on my spears. And that looks good. Let's go ahead and accept, and now we're level 16. So a big jump. And I'd earned the trophy, the beginning of a samurai. Okay, and I'm done with this shrine. Let's go check out the blacksmith.
いらっしゃい.
Welcome, you don't look like you are from around here. My name is Tomi. I help look after grandfather's forges, which are dotted across the land. It would be Tomei. I know how to speak at least some Japanese. Give it the program. Alright, so we can go to her dialogue with Triangle. And she can explain a bunch of stuff. Hey, tell me a story from beyond the seas. I want to know more. And she's going to explain all the sort of different things that she can do. So let's go ahead and find out. So about special finds. Rare, exceptional items available in limited numbers. When you return from a mission, you will find the stock has changed. Okay, so I might need to pay attention to that. About buybacks. If you mistakenly sell items or equipment, you can buy them back at the same price. Buybacks are limited to the last 20 sells. So if I make a mistake, I can get back the item. Pretty standard. About forging. Use materials you own to forge new weapons and armor. Materials are mainly acquired from disassembling other items. About familiarity levels. Indicates the amount of time you have used a piece of equipment. In Japan, there is a long tradition of believing that tools used for many years come to be inhabited by gods or spirits. When you equip items with high familiarity levels, you will receive more Amrita when you pray at a shrine. As equipment reaches certain familiarity levels, its abilities will grow stronger. After reaching maximum familiarity, equipment that has a special effect marked with whatever that symbol is, the Inherit icon, will pass on that special effect if it is used as a material in soul matching. Okay, and about soul matching. Soul matching increases the level of your equipment. The level of the base equipment is overridden by that of the equipment used as a material, and the base equipment's familiarity will be set to zero. If the familiarity of the equipment selected as material is at max, it has a special effect marked with inherit. That special effect can be inherited. So if you've got a good piece of equipment you want to use as the catalyst to increase another, you can pass over effects, which could be very, very powerful. You can select material equipment with a lower level than the base equipment, but the level will not be raised. The item chosen as material will be consumed and disappear in the soul matching process. Okay, and about inheritance. Each piece of equipment can have a maximum of one special effect that can be inherited, as marked with the inherit icon. To transfer the effect marked with the inherit icon, first raise that piece of equipment to maximum familiarity, and then use it as a material and soul matching. If the base equipment does not have an effect with its own inherit icon, then it will inherit the effect. If the base equipment does have an effect with its own inherit icon, then it will be overwritten by the inherited effect. There are also special effect combinations that cannot be inherited. About reforging, allows you to redistribute the special effects of a piece of equipment. When you select multiple special effects and reforge a piece of equipment, you will raise the levels of those special effects. Equipment having special effects with the lock icon and special effects marked with the inherit icon cannot be redistributed. And finally, disassembly. Disassemble a piece of equipment into forging materials. Alright, so let's go ahead and speak to Tome. Feel free to ask me anything about smithing. Alright. So, I'm going to show you a little bit of everything that she was just talking about. So, let's do disassemble first. And we'll just disassemble all the stuff I don't want, which is most of it. And as you can see on the right, you get different materials for each item. So let's just get rid of all this stuff and tell it not to ask me again. Actually, hold on. Do I want that? That looks like a really powerful gun, actually. I might want that. Where's the gun I have? Let's see. Oh, yeah, that's way better. Okay, let's equip that. I almost got rid of something really good. So equip that gun. For the matchlock I have, good. Okay, so let's disassemble this. That was a close one. And I don't want it to ask me again. Disassemble. Same with the rare items. Don't want them to ask me, just do it. And we're gonna get all kinds of stuff because I got lots of items. This one's max familiarity. Yeah, I want to disassemble it anyway. All right, and all this stuff can go. Oh, if I disassemble this, I could get some purple iron kozane, whatever that ends up being. Because I don't think I'm going to use it. Not a big fan of the heavy armor. Yeah, let's go ahead and use it, or disassemble it. And yes, and I do want it to ask me about purples. I don't want to ever slip up and accidentally destroy one of those. That would really suck. So let's get rid of that, that, and that. All these can go. Same with these. Oh, actually, well. Might have just destroyed something I wanted, but that's fine. Wasn't anything super valuable. And let's see, what else we got? Looks like that's it. Okay, so that's disassembling. That got me a bunch of material. Next, I'll show you forging. I'm not gonna actually forge anything, because it doesn't, I don't know if it's really worth it yet. And I handed over the smithing techs I got as pre-order items. So what you can do is you can go to weapon or armor or tools. You can pick something you want to forge. And you can see at the top the rarity level of the forged item. So it's just random. So if I pay my 353 gold, it'll make this sword right here. And it has a 5% chance to be of purple quality, the one of a kind. 41% chance to be rare, 27 to be uncommon, and 27 to also be common. So it's just a lottery, really. And I don't really think it's worth it. It seems to me that upgrading what you have would be better, but I don't know, maybe I'll change my mind later, but for now it doesn't really seem worth it. But you can do the same with armor, and it's the same deal, although the armor seems to have a better chance of being the purple quality. It's 9% rather than 5%. And then we have tools, which is a little more tempting. So we can make these amulets to imbue our weapons, which seem pretty good. And they take the demon's horn, which we have two of them. They were dropping from those yokis. All right, next we have soul match, which is where you raise the level of one of your pieces of equipment. So you can do it with weapons or you can do it with armor. And I'm going to do it with one of my armors because my arm guards are level 1. So let's throw those in. And then we just need to pick... Oh, you know what I did? I made a big mistake. I accidentally disassembled and I wanted to keep one of those as material. Well, I guess we can forge something after all. So we'll forge this, see if this works. So we'll just forge... Oh, the level's random too. Well, that's okay. We'll just forge a light piece of armor. Let's see, where's it? Ah, there we go. So this is light. We could forge this. Or we could forge... Well, there's a few options. I don't think it matters, although the body and skill... I probably want something that takes the stats that I have. And I'm referring to the bottom part, where like this one, for instance, needs body and skill. Body and strength. I think those might be inherited, so I want something that I have a lot of. So none of those really line up with what I'm going with, so I guess we'll just make these. So let's go ahead and craft that. And oh, what's this? I can raise my chances by using stronger equipment. I see. So like I could select this and I could go over to this piece and lower and raise that. Oh, okay, it takes 2 leather kozane and I can pick the rarity. And then based on the rarity I pick, increases the chance of it being a really good item. So that makes sense. And actually that makes me reconsider what I'm gonna use. Oh, but that's, oh, well, I could do this. Wonder if it matters if I use a heavy piece. Probably not. Let's see. I don't want iron kozane because I have a purple of that. But that might be my only option. Wait, times 4. Oh, I see. It's automatically using my best items, I think. So let's go back to this one. Yeah, okay. So let me select this. And I just want to use the quality leather, the lowest I can get. So there we go, and then the iron kozane, get rid of that super high level stuff. I want this because I don't want to make this high level. I'm just using it as a sacrifice, basically. So over there, good, and that looks good. So let's go ahead and forge this and hope it's a decently high level. This will forge Archer Garb Kote. Are you sure you want to proceed? Yes. And it's level 7, perfect. And that got me a trophy, latest masterpiece. Add to inventory. Okay, so that's sort of how it works. So actually it might be worth it because I could just use high level items to increase my chance of getting something purple or higher, or purple or slightly less. So now I should be able to go to soul match and armor and go to my bandit armor, throw that in, and then throw in that piece I just made. And that will boost my current item, the purple ones, to level 7. And it'll retain the same stats. As you can see, the special effects are unaffected. All it's going to change is the defense, which I don't really know if that's worth it, but I just wanted to show you this. And it's also going to require 6 body and 6 skill to wear, which I have. So that works fine, and it's going to cost 2,538 gold, which is not cheap. But I don't know if that's a lot of gold or not. I guess we'll find out. Maybe this will be a mistake, but who cares? We're doing it. This contains an item that is uncommon or better. If your soul match, the material will disappear. Yes, I want to proceed. And there we go. My arm piece has been upgraded. So next we have refashion. This is very simple. Just pick an item you want to change the appearance of, and then sacrifice the item that has the appearance you want. So if you have like a sword, you really like the stats on it, throw that there, pick another sword you like the look of but don't mind losing, and you sacrifice it to refashion the good statted one into the appearance of the crappy statted one. And you can do the same with armor. And you can change your hair apparently, but I have not unlocked that. And then there's also reforge, improve the special effects of equipment. So let's go to armor. We can pick, let's just go with those arm guards. So you can see my arm guards have barehanded attack damage, and I don't attack with my fists, so that is not appealing to me at all. So what I can do is select it, and I can reforge it. And it takes spirit iron chunks, which I have 15 of, and it's going to cost me 994 gold. And what it's going to do is replace that effect with something random. So hopefully you get something you want. But it could be something else you don't want. But let's go ahead and give it a go. And, oh, toughness plus 2. So that could be good, I don't know. But much better than barehanded attack damage, so I will take it. Alright, and that's pretty much everything with the blacksmith. I don't know how important this is going to end up being. Well, actually, let's go to buy and sell. She might have some special stuff. She was mentioning she has, like, special one-time thing, special finds, but yeah, nothing I care about. And if I wanted some money, I could sell items to her, but I'm mostly gonna be sacrificing and disassembling my items, I think. So I doubt I'll ever be selling anything to her, but we'll see. Okay, we're done with the blacksmith. Let's go. What's in my storehouse? This is my storage. Just some stones, they can stay there. And we got the dojo, so let's go there. So this is where you do tutorial missions, or training missions. So we've got the basic action controls, the applied action controls. Now I already did these two. This was the tutorial mission I did on the second part of the walkthrough, and for some reason it's split into two different tutorials and it's not checked off, which bugs me. So let me go ahead and run these real quick. I'll just skip through because I want those checked. And then we'll do the Way of the Ninja Novice. So let's skip forward. Okay, so I redid those tutorials and now you can see they're checked off. And let's go ahead and do the Way of the Ninja Novice. It's mission level 5. Get some rewards for it. And it says you can only use specified items and equipment in this mission. All right, let's do it. Ah, William, you have come. If you are interested, I would be happy to teach you what I know of the way of the ninja to you. Oh, I know you are strong, but soon you will face enemies against whom a frontal attack will lead only to disaster. A ninja, however, strikes from behind. Our strength lies in controlling the battlefield itself. Mastering our techniques will make you a greater warrior yet.
Hajime!
Begin. All right. Famed ninjas locks. So if we go to our items, A lock of hair from a famed ninja who fell in battle. It is used to obtain 5 ninja skill points. Since ancient times, the hair of the deceased is said to harbor mystical powers that grant strength and protection to those who keep it on their person. So let's use that. And that gives us 5 ninja points. Use skill points from the learn skill option in the status menu to learn a skill. Alright. And you can see none of my skills from my sword are there. That's because this is just a training mission. So you don't need to think too much about what you're going to spend. It's not going to stay that way. So just spend it on whatever. And we'll just use... What's this? Oh, do we have to buy this? I'm confused. No, never mind, we can't. Let's just get some kunai. Allows you to prepare 7 kunai. Kunai are heavier than shuriken and cause correspondingly more damage when thrown. Let's try that. Or, never mind, it won't let me. It only lets me buy the shuriken shooter. After throwing a shuriken, pressing the assigned button again throws another shuriken. Okay, and that might be all I can buy. Let's see. Oh, nope, I can also get makibishi. Allows you to ready 4 makibishi. Scatter them on the ground to injure the feet of pursuers, slowing them down. And that is all. You can ready ninjutsu and onmyo magic skills at a shrine, and then assign them to shortcuts like items. I think I got a new Amrita memory, I did. It says learning skills. Learn a skill, use skill points from the learn skill option in the status menu to learn a skill. Skill points can be acquired from items, leveling up, or becoming proficient in a weapon, which we've done before. And readying skills. Ready a skill, you can ready ninjutsu and onmyo magic skills at a shrine, and then assign them to shortcuts like items. Each type of skill has a limit to its number of uses, which can be increased by leveling dexterity and magic. Here's my shrine. The ability Ready Jutsu has been unlocked. Okay, and let's see. Our ninjutsu capacity is 15, and these only cost 3 each. So let's just put them all on. Okay, so let's set that as a shortcut. That will do. So it's just like items, like it said. Just put them on shortcuts. So we got the shuriken, and we've got blinding shell, which I didn't buy, but apparently we have now. It allows you to ready 2 blinding shells. They explode when thrown, sending a cloud of particles into the air. Enemies affected by them will be rendered unable to shoot or throw weapons. We'll put that on, and put that in a shortcut. And we also got the makibishi. Allows you to ready 4 makibishi, like it said earlier. Ready it, and put it on a shortcut. Okay. And we've got enemies somewhere. Here they come. So, let's try the makibishi. Haha, nice. Like it. Here's a shuriken. Not a ton of damage, but it's something. And it's ranged. Range is also always good. Let's try the blinding shell. Oh, totally missed. Try it again. Oh, there we go. And he's blinded, so he can't do anything. I can just punch him down. Let's see. Makibishi. Sure you can. Let's just lay a whole bunch of traps for him. Let him run through them. Poor guy. Can't even get to me. And I guess I just gotta punch him down now. If I can grapple him. Nope, but I can kick him. Oh, I kicked his head off. Wow. That's enough. Mission complete. Let's go forward. This will end the mission. Proceed? Yes. The way of the ninja novice. You have a knack for this, William. With this level of diligent practice, you will undoubtedly master more difficult techniques. I will impart further secrets another time. Do not neglect your training in the meantime. And he gave me some pieces of gear and also one of those locks of hair, which should give me some ninja skill points. Okay, so we're pretty much all set. Did the training I want to do. We checked out the map and lore and all that stuff. So, next video, we'll be doing probably this side mission over here, the sub mission. So, thank you for watching, and I will see you next time.